delighted to be here with you and to, after 6 months, being able to come in into the room. I want to give praise to God and express thanks to those who, week after week, you know, set up tents and all that, and then for, you know, every one of you in the heat, you know, sitting out there and worshiping the Lord together. And as I said, when I first came back, you know, whether you're inside or outside, you know, you can still worship God in spirit and in truth. He's not boxed in, you know. We don't worship him better here than we do outside necessarily. And, but anyway, we're in. And we've exercised caution. Everyone has a different opinion, but we exercise real caution. And so we're out there for 3 months. And we're moving in, and you know, we have guidelines up there for you. I sent them out in the mail yesterday, an email, and we want you to follow those if you would, in humility. We all have to put on humility and work together. And we're not starting off with congregational singing. Today I'm going to have the honor of singing to you, to build you up, praise God. Lindy's going to end the service with a song. Make a melody in your heart and think about what's being sung, and I trust that God will build you up in that way. And I just urge you to continue to be patient as we try to wisely navigate through this time as a church. I know churches are different. We've got the people here, and so we've got to make decisions for the people that we have here. We're trying to make wise decisions for a number of reasons. Now next week, the time is going to change. We started today at 9, next week 10. Straight up. Not 9:45, 10 o'clock. And the length of the service will stay about the same, about 45 minutes. And then we'll ride that out until we think we can make the next adjustment. 10 o'clock, let's sleep a little longer. But 10 o'clock, we're going to start. I've had a bad habit through the years of, you know, waiting until a few more people come, so it's, you know, 10:05, whatever. I'm going to try to start right at 10. If you brought any baby items, that Coca-Cola bin out there, it gets pretty full, but just put things around it, and this week we'll deliver it, or they'll come and pick it up. But thank you for your generosity. Tuesday and Wednesday, Zoom fellowship meetings will happen this week. Tuesday and Wednesday at 7. It needs to be sent out by Tuesday early. Also, the offering is in that can down there by the door as you walk in. There's an offering plate on it so that you get the hint. But on your way out, feel free to give. And once again, you're giving as an expression of your gratitude to Christ for saving you and making you a part of God's family. And you're giving out of gratitude for that and for the mission that God has given to us as a church to carry out the gospel to the world. This time, hear the call to worship from Ephesians chapter 1. Chapter 1, verse 3 and verse 7. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ Jesus. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace. For there Paul tells you that you have a Redeemer in the person of Jesus Christ. And because we have a Redeemer, we have been forgiven of our sins through faith in Christ. Yeah. Help us all, Father, to genuinely rejoice over the gift of your Son and all that it means and has meant and will mean for us in the past, present, and into the future. As we think about your goodness to us in Christ the Redeemer, we all admit that we fall short of your glory. We don't always live up to the redemption that we have in Christ. We sin against you and others. And so at this time we ask your forgiveness, your cleansing from our sins. Father, we remember those who can't be here this morning, either because of underlying conditions that make it dangerous for them to be here, for those who are sick, infirmed, or who may be out of town. Father, be with them. Remind them of your great love for them. Be at work in them, making them more and more into the image of your dear Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Father, we think of the churches in the ARP, our denomination, and beyond those churches that are faithful to your word and proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ. Father, continue to bless your church. As your church tries to be faithful, even in a time like this, during this pandemic, and all the changes that have taken place, Lord, help us all to be faithful and strengthen those who minister your word, and they be faithful in giving their people, your people, the word, so that they can grow and change and have strength and hope in this life. Father, we think of Reverend Kim, who pastors a church in the ARP in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. Father, I pray for him, his wife, his family, for the body of believers that are gathering this morning in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. Would you encourage them and bless their worship this morning, bless it to their edification? Enlarge your church by drawing the unbeliever to Jesus Christ for salvation. Father, we also remember various ways, let alone they're leaving a familiar culture and they've been into a whole different culture. But we pray, Father, for them. We pray for Rebecca Carson, the ministers in Berlin. Bless her and the church that she's a part of as a missionary. Bless the pastor there. Bless the work there. May much fruit come about through the faithful work that is being done. May men and women come to Christ. May the body of Christ be built up. Father, we're grateful for this time, for the opportunity here today to gather in this building. Thank you for the gift that you've given us here. And I pray your blessing on each one here. May each one today be sincerely, Father, be built up and encouraged in their walk with you. May we all leave here today with a spring in our step because we've heard from you. And we are leaving more grateful for Christ's work on the cross for us. Lord, we commit this service to you, to your glory, for our well-being. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hear the scripture reading this morning from Romans. Romans chapter 5, verses 6 through 11. For while we were still helpless, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For rarely will someone die for a just person, though for a good person, perhaps someone might even dare to die. But God proves his own love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. How much more then, since we have now been declared righteous by his blood, will we be saved through him from wrath? For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, then how much more, having been reconciled, will we be saved by his life? And not only that, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received this reconciliation. This is the word of God. It's inspired, it's authoritative, it's sufficient for you and for me to know God and to live for him. You know, it's not uncommon for some Christians to doubt God's love for them at certain points in their lives. It can become a problem when life is hard. They have a particular trial that is very difficult. And short of that, it just lasts forever. It seems like it's never going away. Sometimes it's financial problems, health issues that linger, and relational turmoil. These are common culprits. Usually after a season of dealing with trials like this, some believers actually begin to question, and if God loves me, why does he allow these trials to continue day after day? I'm not so sure anymore of his love for me. And that can be true of you. You who are here today. In fact, it may be true of someone who is actually here. And if not now, it might be sometime down the road. If you find yourself there, I urge you to take a good look at the cross of Christ. And what Paul says here in the inspiration of the Holy Spirit in Romans chapter 5, verses 6 through 11. In short, what Paul is saying is that the cross of Christ proves God's love for you, for all of his people for whom Christ died. In this passage, for Paul to make his point, he shares several gospel truths gospel truths that you need to bring to mind and consider when doubt of God's love begins to creep into your mind. The first gospel truth that you need to consider, brothers and sisters in Christ, is that God has proven his love for you because of when Christ died for you. Paul says that Christ died for you just at the right time, meaning just at the time that God had planned before the foundation of the world. That's when he made his plan. And at that time, he planned the death of his son. And when Christ died, he didn't die one day earlier or one day later. It was right on time. God, in a very loving, wise, and perfect way, planned the death of his son for you. And when he did die in God's plan, he died for his people when they were weak, helpless, morally weak. We were creatures of the fall. And since that's the case, Paul says Christ died for you when his people were ungodly. When they were still sinners, Paul says. When they were living in ways contrary to the will of God, contrary to the holy character of God. And this is why Paul says that Christ died for you when his people, people like you and me, were enemies. Enemies in the sense that God thought of you as his enemies. Now, when someone is outside of Christ, they are, by virtue of their moral nature, their sinful nature, and the sins that they commit, they're enemies. They look at God as an enemy. But that's not what Paul is talking about here. He's talking about the fact that because we are the fallen creatures that we are, weak and sinful and ungodly, God views us as his enemies. Brothers and sisters, that's how God thought of you and me when we were outside of Christ, as his enemies. Well, Paul is, here writing under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, and he thinks it's unthinkable that God would do that. In the ancient world, one would rarely die for someone who was just, someone who was righteous, who really had their act together and did all these good, righteous things. Though for a good person, Paul says, someone who did good to other people and warmed their lives and did good to them, was kind, someone might dare die for a person like that. But that's not what we're talking about in relationship to Christ and his death. Christ died for sinners, for people like you and me. Paul says, as he reasons under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, puts it down, he says, that's proof of God's love for you. You see, there wasn't anything in you or me, of anyone for whom Christ died, that moved God to love you, love me. God's love came from within himself. And God freely and sovereignly and wisely and kindly and perfectly demonstrated, proved his love for you. Everything within us was opposed to him. And thus, instead of his love, we deserved his just punishment, his wrath. We were his sinful enemies. And isn't that what you do with an enemy? You defeat him. You win. Well, if and when you ever begin to doubt the love of God for you because life is hard, go to the cross and remember when Christ died for you. He died for you when you were ungodly, when you were a sinner, when you kind of people for whom Christ died, sinners. But there's more here for you to consider. Consider that God has proven his love for you by what he accomplished when Christ died. Christ died for you so that you could be justified, Paul says. Translation that I've read once says declared righteous. That's what justification means, to declare righteous. When you think of justification, you need to go to the courtroom. You ever been to a courtroom? If you haven't personally, I'm sure you've seen it on TV or something like that. You know what it looks like. There's the courtroom. God, the holy judge of the universe, is there on the bench, and there you are standing before him, morally frail, a fallen human being, ungodly, a sinner, and an enemy, deserving eternal punishment, deserving God's wrath. But as a result of God's gift of faith to you, you applied and expressed toward in Jesus Christ, the Christ who lived for you and died for you in order to pay for your sins. When you placed your faith in Christ, God declared you righteous in his sight. At that moment, he began to look at you as if you had never sinned, but instead lived the righteous life that Christ lived. I don't want to pass quickly over that, because I think that's hugely important. Christ not only died for you, he had to do that, pay for your sins. You deserve a death penalty. He paid it, took care of it. But before he did that, he lived for you a life of righteousness. In his humanity, he lived a righteous life before his Father, for his honor, in order to earn your salvation. So that one day you could stand before a holy God and God could look at you and say, you are righteous. So when you, as I said, placed your faith in Christ, you were not only forgiven because Christ died, paid the debt, but then you were clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And right now, here this morning, that's exactly how God looks at you if you're in Christ. He sees you just as if you've never sinned. He sees you just as if you lived the righteous life that Christ lived. How often do you think about that? How often do you think about that when you really screw up? You lose your cool with your kids or with your spouse. You do something really, really stupid. And sometimes, some of us, all of us at some time, just go around beating ourselves up. And you're in a bad mood for the rest of the day. And sometimes people, depending on what we're talking about, can go a long time dwelling on all that. And yeah, we've got to be serious about sin, and we need to square it away before God, but you need to know that God views you as a righteous person, just as if you lived the righteousness of Christ. So look at that and consider that when you blow it. And say, Jesus, I see why you came. This is a reminder to me today that you came and lived the perfect life which I've demonstrated I can't live. Thank you for living that life for me. And I'm so grateful that I can be considered righteous in your sight. Now help me, Holy Spirit, to walk in step with the Spirit and live a righteous life myself. Because that's how God views me. I think that's a big deal, folks. In the years of counseling that I've done, I have found that many Christians don't understand that aspect of the gospel. And they find themselves living and doing right, sort of with a performance mentality in order to sort of balance the scales. I really messed up on Friday. So Saturday, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, and hopefully the scale will be balanced. and God will, you know, love me. That didn't work that way. Christ has filled up the scale. You are righteous. Christ balances the scales. You're accepted by God and you're loved by God perfectly. God can't love you any more than he loves you already. Now, that's implied in all that Paul says, I believe, in my own words. But what Paul does say is a great outcome. It's the fact that there's no wrath coming your way. None. No wrath is coming your way. What's coming your way is the fullness of eternal life. You have it now, but more is coming. When Jesus Christ parts the sky, he's going to bring his salvation, the fullness of your salvation, and usher you into a new heavens and a new earth where righteousness will be at home. So no future punishment. Just eternal life. Paul starts thinking again. He reasons this way about God's love for you here. He uses a greater to lesser argument in verse 9. He says, how much more then, since we have now been declared righteous by his blood, will we be saved through him from wrath? So if God did the greater thing of justifying you by Christ's blood, when you were still a sinner, an enemy, will he not save you from his wrath in the last day as one who is considered righteous in his sight? And the answer is absolutely yes. No doubt about it. Wrath is God's personal indignation towards his enemies who in human pride and rebellion sin against him. And it's eternal death. It's to be separated from the glorious presence of Christ forever and ever and to suffer eternal torment. Colin Cruz in his commentary said, God's wrath is the ultimate threat confronting sinners. Not sin itself, not Satan, not even death, but God's wrath. You're not going to face it. Christ faced it for you at the cross. You're righteous. So God's going to bless you with his kindness for all eternity. That's love. God's love for you. It's proof that he loves you. Coupled with God's justifying grace, Paul talks about something else that demonstrates God's love, and that's reconciliation. As I said earlier, sinners, you were regarded by God as his enemies. Verse 10. However, because Christ died for you in order to declare you forgiven and righteous, we, you and me, and all of his people, have peace with God now. The hostility, the enmity is gone. Peace has filled up the room. It's taken over. Paul says in verse 1 in the same chapter, therefore, since we have been declared righteous by faith, there is justification, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. That's reconciliation. God looks upon you as a friend, as a part of the family. If justification is the courtroom, reconciliation is the living room. Where God comes and metaphorically grabs you by the hand and says, come on in. Ushers you into his living room and says, take a seat. You're now my friend and my family. Your home. No longer an enemy, you're my friend. Paul once again uses a greater to lesser argument in verse 10. It says, for if while we were enemies, you were reconciled to God through the death of his son, then how much more, having been reconciled, will we be saved by his life? Meaning, so if God through Christ has done the greater thing of reconciling you to himself, how much more will God do the lesser thing of giving you the fullness of salvation on the last day through Christ, the resurrected God-man who lives to make intercession for you so that you will be saved completely. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25. Brothers and sisters in Christ, God has proven his love to you by justifying you and by reconciling you through the death of Christ and his resurrection. And both witnesses, Paul says, have secured your future with God. And all of this was done not when you were righteous, not when you were good, but when you were sinners, ungodly, when you were his enemies. Consider this next time when you begin to doubt God's love for you. You are loved by God far more than you can imagine. The Lord's Supper certainly aids all of us this morning in considering the proven love of God for us in Christ. Just picture, you know, this meal here today, stamped with the words, proven. Proven love. God's done it. He's proven his love for you. May God bless us all with a renewed sense of God's love. And in turn, may we rejoice, as Paul says in verse 11. And not only that, but we rejoice in God, through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received this reconciliation. Let's pray. God, our Father in heaven, how deep your love is. You have proven your love beyond a shadow of a doubt on the basis of your inspired, holy, all-sufficient, authoritative word. You have stated very clearly that you love us. And you've shown how you've proven it in your Son. And we give you praise and we rejoice this morning in our justification, in our reconciliation, in our salvation provided for us in Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, at this time we're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper. And once again, it's going to be done a little differently than we've done it in the past. We have wafer and juice cup sets up here. It's all wrapped up and safe. It was handled with plastic gloves and everything. So anyway, what I want you to do in the back row and then leading up to the row here, those in the back, you guys will go to this wall, you to this wall, you come down the side aisle, come get your juice cup, go to the center aisle and go into your seats. We'll do it row by row until we come to Cameron and Sharon. And once you get your cups, you can be seated, obviously. You could be figuring out how you're going to open it up. The first layer is the wafer. Okay? Second layer is the juice. So I'll give you something to do and as you go. Listening to me give you the words of institution. Okay? So, let us proceed, Tom, and then you guys out there. Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, something like this. He took bread, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you, for your forgiveness. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." And every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death, the death of the risen Lord, until he comes again. These words remind us that Jesus wants you to remember him by his death. That's crystal clear. It's a big deal. It was the means by which he ratified the new covenant so that you could be forgiven, so that you could be saved. Also in these words, you were invited to be participants by eating the bread, symbolizing Jesus' body, given for you, and the cup, symbolizing his shed blood. These two actions point to you having received Christ as Savior at some point in the past, as well as presently you feeding on Christ by faith. And in this way, it's a means of grace. And may the Lord bless you in that regard this morning. If you have yet to receive Christ as your Lord and Savior, we would ask that you refrain. And we ask because that is what Christ would want. Until you have personally received the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, this points to that reality. And but you can participate this morning. You can participate by actually receiving Christ, asking him to forgive you of your sin, to be your Savior. And he will. He'll save you. He'll forgive you. Like that, you'll be a child of God. Now, as we partake this morning, let's begin with a prayer of confession. I want to give you all an opportunity to talk to God yourselves. I think it's important that we be real with God. We can't pull the wool over God's eyes. There is sin in your life, God would want you to talk to him and deal with that. And then after you've done that, I will then do this in corporate confession. So let's pray. Holy Father in heaven, thank you for your Son. Thank you for your love in sending him to be our Savior. Because we're sinners, we're enemies, we're ungodly, we're so morally weak. You're deserving of your wrath, but you loved us instead. And you sent your Son to deal with our sinful state. We've been forgiven. But our Father, you know that as your children, we still stray. And we still sin in our hearts, sin in our words, we sin in the way we conduct ourselves. You know it. And so we simply confess what you already know. We admit our sin to you, our Father. We're so grateful that we don't have to run and hide, that we can run to you because you really, really love us. And so we run to you at this moment, asking forgiveness for our sins. I pray this in your Son's name, Father, Jesus, our elder brother. Amen. It's my turn. These common elements are given to us by Christ as symbols of the body and blood of Christ. May God bless these to our spiritual edification. Brothers and sisters, take, eat, remember, and believe that the body of our Lord Jesus Christ is given for complete remission of all your sins. Family of God, this cup, this juice, represents the shed blood of Jesus Christ. So, take, drink, remember, and believe the precious blood of our Lord Jesus Christ was shed for a complete remission of all your sins. There's a trash can on your way out, okay? Join me in a word of thanksgiving today. Father, we thank you. We thank you for your everlasting love. As John wrote, for you so loved God, you so loved the world, that you gave your one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Thank you for that. As we leave this place and enter into the world, Lord, help us to remember you, to remember your great love, and live in life. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen. love of God, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now, all throughout the week and forevermore. Amen.